Every dollar counts, especially in uncertain times. Even if car insurance isn't top of mind now, saving money always is. Direct Auto Insurance is here to help you find the affordable coverage you need with discounts up to 25% and flexible payment options. Click to start your free, no obligation quote and see how Direct Auto can help you save on your car insurance today.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So glad to have you this morning. The songwriter says, one more day, one more day. He allowed us to come together just one more day. And because of that, we're grateful and we're thankful that he's given us one more day. For those of you here in the sanctuary, we welcome you. We thank you for being here. For those of you who are joining us at home, we thank you for tuning in. And we pray God's blessing upon this service. The psalmist in Psalm 23 gives us this message. And this is from the New Living Translation. The Lord is my shepherd. I have all that I need. He lets me rest in green pastures. And he leads me beside peaceful streams. He renews my strength. And he guides me along the right paths, bringing honor to his name. Even when I walk through the darkest valley, I will not be afraid, for you are close beside me. Your rod and your staff protect and comfort me. You prepare a feast for me in the presence of my enemies. You honor me. By anointing my head with oil, so much so that my cup overflows with blessings. And then here's the promise. God's sheepdogs, surely goodness and mercy, goodness and his unfailing love will pursue me all the days of my life. And because they will, I will live in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. God's sheepdogs, goodness and mercy will hunt me down.
Thank you, Lord.
And take me over, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Yeah. Reverend Ross, would you come and open us up with a prayer?
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Eternal God, our Father, Lord, our Creator, our Maker, and our Sustainer. God, we thank you for the gift of life this day. We thank you, God, for watching over us as we slept and slumbered on last evening and allowing us to awaken to a brand new day full of brand new mercies. We thank you, oh God, for your loving kindness and your tender mercies, God. We thank you for allowing us to assemble ourselves together wherever we are, touching and agreeing to honor your name, to give your name glory, honor, and praise. We thank you, oh God, that we have a God to call on who sits high and who looks low. We thank you that you are our Father, Abba Father, whose name we can call on, who is higher than any other. God, we ask right now that you would look upon us with mercy and compassion, and that you would bless those who are less fortunate and without, oh God. That you would be with those who are sick and afflicted, and that you would send your healing virtue to not only hover over, but to touch their bodies, so that there will be a remnant that will give your name glory, that all will see and know that you still are in the healing business, oh God. And we thank you. We ask, oh God, that your compassion will not only hover over, but touch and invade the hearts of those who have lost loved ones, oh God, who are in their hour of darkness and sadness. For God, we know that you are a comforter, oh God, and that you would teach each of us things that we must say and do that would help lift up their bowed heads. God, we ask that you would be with us as we seek to glory and honor your name this morning. Be thy glorified in us today. Let every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of anyone that is in this service, let it be helpful, let it be full of hope, and let it be full of healing. And most important, let it honor you. We thank you now, God, for the shepherd of this house. And we pray, oh God, that you would move mightily through him, that you will speak through him as you speak to him, that your people may be edified. And overall, God, that you will be glorified. Have your way in this worship experience this morning, for we seek to honor you in spirit and in truth, for there is no one likened unto you. We give you glory right now, O God. We give your name honor, and we give you praise. And it is in the precious name of your Son, Jesus the Christ, we do pray. Amen.
Hallelujah, as we keep that worship going. The Bible says, enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be faithful unto him and bless his name. For the Lord is good, and his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures to all generations. See, this isn't a show. This isn't for show, form, or fashion, but we come to bless the Lord this morning because God has kept us another day. Reverend Bacon said, one more day that the Lord has kept us. How many of you are glad that he's kept you one more day? This song simply says, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Can you help us sing this song? Come on, get up out that bed. Come on, get up out that couch and praise the Lord with us. Here we go, praise it. Right here. See, I will
bless the Lord.
Yes, I will. Say, oh my soul.
Oh my soul.
Come on,
come on, come on and bless him. Come on and praise his name. Come on, come on and bless him.
One more time. Come on, come on,
come on, come on and bless him. Come on and praise his name. Come on, come on and bless him.
See, I will
bless the Lord.
Say, all of my soul.
All my
everybody say, come on.
Come on, come on and bless him. Come on and praise his name. Come on, come on and bless him.
Come on and praise
Him. Come on and bless Him. Come on and praise His name. Come on and bless Him. For the Lord delights in showing mercy.
Come on, everybody say, for the Lord.
For the Lord delights in showing mercy.
Let's say that one more time. For the Lord.
For the Lord delights in showing mercy.
We're going to say that twice. Come on.
For the Lord delights in showing mercy.
We're going to last time. For the Lord.
For the Lord delights in showing mercy.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Everybody, everybody say.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah is the highest praise.
Hallelujah.
Can you open your mouth and say hallelujah?
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah is the highest praise.
Hallelujah.
Open your mouth and say
hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Oh, that part.
Hey, Lord, you're worthy of the glory and the honor.
Hallelujah. You say, Lord.
Lord, you're worthy of the glory and the honor. Hallelujah.
Lord, you're worthy.
Lord, you're worthy
of the glory.
Of the glory
and the honor.
And the honor.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I can't stop praising.
I can't stop praising.
Can't stop dancing.
Can't stop dancing.
You've been too good, Lord.
You've been so good, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Lord, you're worthy.
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 Lord, you're holy.
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 Lord, holy God.
Lord, you're holy.
Lord, you're holy.
Lord, you're holy.
Go to the next part. Just help us say this. It's call and response. My praise is a weapon.
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 My praise is a weapon. Is my weapon. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This song just simply says intentional. Hallelujah. Y'all know this song. Can you just help us sing it? Hallelujah. Come on, pray, sing.
Oh.
Facebook Live, where we're led by the Reverend Wayne Allen Sr. and First Lady Jackie Allen. We hope that you already feel welcome in our worship experience. We hope that when we come back into worship that you come and be a part of this great branch of Zion. Hey, good to see you. We're so glad that you are worshiping with us this morning. Good to see you. So glad you're here. Thank you, Jesus.
So glad that you're here. So glad that you joined us this morning. And just a couple of reminders. For now, the food warehouse located at 1043 Northwest 8th Street will continue to distribute food until the food is gone each day. For now, it will still be Monday through Friday until the food is gone. When the food is gone, they will close the warehouse, and until further notice, that is the way we will continue. Monday through Friday, they will serve you in your cars. You are asked to wear a mask, drive up service only, and first come, first serve. A reminder about the upcoming election: the vote by mail ballots should have been in your mailboxes beginning on Saturday, July the 11th. Please be advised that no one should come to your home to help you complete your ballot. There will be a pastor's pick available that you may use when completing your ballot. Again, there will be a pastor's pick distributed, and you may use that to complete your ballot when it is received. And again, no one should come to your home to help you fill out your ballot. If someone does, that's a red flag. Ballots should have been in your mailboxes beginning on Saturday, July the 11th. Thank you so much for your attention.
As we prepare for the preach word, there's this little old school medley that we're going to bless you with. We hope it blessed somebody's soul.
Hallelujah, thine the glory.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah, amen. Thine the glory, revive us again. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah. glory. Revive us again.
Jesus. Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
About that name,
yes.
Oh, Master,
Savior,
Jesus, like the fragrance, Jesus.
Through it all.
all, just say through it all, yeah.
Through it all.
Come on, just say it softly.
I've learned to trust in Jesus.
Come on, I've learned to trust in God.
I've learned to trust in God.
Come on, can everybody just say through it all?
Through it all.
Name in all the earth, how excellent is thy name. For your name is great and greatly to be praised. God, we honor you today. We worship and adore you. As we come before you in this place, God, pray that you would be honored with our presence, that you would be pleased with our praise. Sanctify us unto yourself, Father, for this time of service. Consecrate us unto thyself for your service. God, we seek your blessings. We seek for your approval. That we will be blessed in all that we do for you. Continue to bless this praise team. Continue to bless these musicians. Continue to bless this media ministry. Continue to bless those who continue to come and support to make this all possible, Father, as we continue to declare your gospel, the gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Pray, God, that you would bless those that have tuned in, bless their homes, their families. Pray, God, that something will be said or done that will inspire them today, that if they don't know the Lord Jesus as their Savior, that they will come to know and accept him as their Lord and Savior. We pray, God, that someone will be saved. God, I decrease that you may increase. Use me for your glory. Use me for your good pleasure. Stand by me. Stand with me. Use me, God, for your glory. Let the words of my mouth, the meditation of my heart, be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. In Jesus the Christ's name we pray. Amen. 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 You may be seated. Let me just say this because I know, you know, with the help of Facebook and Instagram and all of the other components where people are able to make their voices heard but not their appearances. The church has not officially opened for service because we don't have all the components in place to open back up for service. But you can, if you choose to, come and sit in the service as long as you're willing to have your temperature checked, that you have on a face mask, and that you continue to practice the social distancing. What you all see on Sunday morning is those who are here to help make sure that we are able to go live. No one that's here has to be here. No one that's here is forced to be here. I just want to make that clear because there have been some posts concerning our service. This is all an effort to continue to declare God's word. We are taking every precautionary measure that we are supposed to be. And we are in compliance with the guidelines that have been set. And just in case you don't know, there are guidelines for a church service, and there are guidelines for a funeral service, just so we will be clear. And we are in compliance with the guidelines of what we are doing here. And so I just wanted to make that clear so that we will all be on the same page and we will be clear in what we're saying and what we are doing. Amen? Amen. Amen. Back to Genesis 39. As we continue with the proposition and the positioning. And last week I talked about in the ways of temptation, we talked about the many different ways that temptation will come. We talked also about the works of temptation, how temptation will work its way into your life. And we talked about the wits in temptation, dealing with the vileness of how temptation will come and how it can be vigorous, how it can be aggressive, how it can be persistent. And so we covered those things on last week. And so this week I wanted to deal with the war against temptation. We dealt with, as I mentioned, the ways of temptation, the works of temptation, and the wits of temptation. And so I want to finish this here with the war against temptation. How was Joseph able to fight off the temptation? And as I mentioned before, it wasn't just about the proposition, but it was the ways in which temptation can disguise itself and how temptation can present itself. And so in the war against temptation, Joseph utterly refused the proposition of Potiphar's wife. He was victorious over temptation, and he gives us some good lessons on how to war successfully against the matter of temptation. Now, there are a number of other things that we are to do, but I just want to highlight three of the things that Joseph did that enabled him to fight the war successfully against the temptation. First, he did not waver in his stand. If you're going to stand for the Lord, you're going to have to stand boldly and you're going to have to stand faithfully. One thing God does not need is no wavering Christians. One thing God does not need who are those who are saved on Sunday. It's amazing how we get so saved and sanctified on Sunday morning. In the book of Revelations, when the angel of the church spoke to the church at Laodicea, Jesus said to the church of Laodicea, he says, "You're not hot nor cold, you're lukewarm," which means you're in between. In other words, he was simply saying, you don't know if you're saved or you want to be. And so Jesus says that I spew you out of my mouth because of your undecisiveness. You don't even know whether or not you want to be saved. And so Joseph, he didn't waver in his stand. First, there is the dogmatism of his stand, but he refused. He hearkened not. Every time Joseph was solicited to sin by Potiphar's wife, he dogmatically declined the invitation to do so. One of the most effective weapons against temptation is a sanctified, dogmatic no. In Galatians 5:1, Paul says to stand fast, therefore, in the liberty whereby Christ has made you free, and do not be entangled again with a yoke of bondage. Temptation leads to sin. And Paul says, since we are no longer bound by sin, he says, stand fast in the liberty that has set you free. Joseph dogmatically said no every time. And to dogmatically say no, which simply means that you can't even look at my facial expression and think I'm thinking something else. When he says dogmatically no, it shows all over his expression, all over his appearance, that no means no. This ain't one of those instances where I'm saying no, but I really mean yes. No, no, he dogmatically said no. There is no reading in between this dogmatic no. If you're going to stand, you have to stand firmly. And those who are opposing you, those who are presenting you with the temptation, needs to understand and know where you stand. One of the reasons why folk will continue to come at us the way they come at us is because we've wavered in time past. And because we've wavered in time past, they simply believe that we're going to waver again. And so they continue to come because they have a hope that if I can get them to waver just one more time, I have them. And that's the reason why they keep coming. Potiphar's wife kept coming at Joseph simply because she had another agenda. It wasn't just about her sleeping with Joseph. It was about her getting him to fall. Because of where he was walking. Because of his position. You got to understand something. There are some folk who hate the fact that you're in the position that you're in. There are some folk who have been from the beginning trying to get you to stumble and fall because they envy the position you're walking in. They envy where God is taking you. Everybody ain't pleased because you've been promoted. Don't fool yourself. You ain't all of that, and folk don't like you because you're all of that. Don't let nobody fool you. Everybody don't like you. Joseph dogmatically said no, but then there is also the dependability in the stand. He has committed all that he has to my hand. Potiphar had promoted Joseph to be the overseer of his house and trusted Joseph so much he committed all that he had to Joseph. For Joseph to do this thing with Potiphar's wife would have been a great betrayal of his trust. You got to understand something, that when folk present you with temptation, it's not just the picture that you see in front of you. When you give in to the temptation, there's a whole lot of things that's going to happen. There's a whole lot of things that's going to occur. There's a whole lot of folk that are going to be hurt by you falling to this temptation. It's a bigger picture than what you're looking at. It has greater implications. Joseph, if you go back to the beginning of the lesson, God has Joseph in this place because Joseph is going to save an entire nation. And you got to know the ramifications of where God has positioned you. There's a great number of people that's going to benefit from where God has positioned you. And so if the enemy could get Joseph to fall, guess what? The whole nation of Israel falls. The dependability in the stands. Joseph would be dependable. Dependability is a shield that will block temptation very effectively. It puts people at a place of ease when they know that they can depend on you. I used to say all the time, you know, I mentioned this here before because my mom had 11 kids. They were busy. Or they was bored. One of the two. But I love my family because, I love my family. I love my sisters and brothers, and we got along like sisters and brothers supposed to get along. But my mom used to call me to do stuff all the time. Now, I wouldn't never say this to her, but I would say in my mind, you have 11 kids. There is no reason why you should be calling me every time you need something done. I didn't realize till later in life it was something that God put in me that made me as dependable as I was. And I realized that my mom was only calling me because she knew she could depend on me. That whatever she was asking me to do, she knew that I would do it. My boss on the job was the same way. I would get upset. Why are you always calling me? There's 10 other people that work in here. That dependability puts people at a place of ease when they know they have someone that's dependable. Someone who they can ask to do something. They don't have to go back and check. They don't have to wonder if it's going to be done. Someone who they can depend on. Someone who they can trust. That I'm putting this in your hands. And I know that it's going to be done. I thank God for what he's given me. Potiphar trusted Joseph, not even knowing Joseph, but just because he realized that God had his hand on Joseph, he knew that he could depend on him. And so Potiphar put all that he had in Joseph's hand. He was dependable in his stand. He was dogmatic in his stand. He didn't waver. There was no back and forth. But not only did he not waver in his stand, he didn't waver in his service. Joseph committed his service unto the Lord. He committed his life to serving the Lord. He committed himself to pleasing the Lord. And because of that, it helped him to establish an unbreakable bond, a relationship that would only be strengthened in time. He didn't waver in his service. Note first the discerning in his service. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? He hearkened not unto her to lie by her or to be with her. Joseph could discern the evil of what Potiphar's wife wanted. He did so in a twofold way. First, he could discern the character of her evil. Joseph refused to do this evil. He referred to it as a great wickedness. This was more than just an act of immorality. She wanted Joseph to also betray the trust that also had been given unto him. How does one obtain a discerning spirit in regards to sin? It comes through acquaintance with divine revelation that stems from one's service unto the Lord. The psalmist said, through thy precepts I get understanding. Therefore, I hate every false way. It comes through relationship. It's about who do you want to please more? That's why we continue to encourage you. Read the Bible. Study the Bible. Develop your devotional time, because discernment comes through divine revelation. You don't know the thoughts and intents of people's heart unless you got a relationship with God. And because Joseph had a relationship with the Lord, he could discern the evilness of Potiphar's wife. He understood that it was far beyond me just sleeping with you. There was some character of evilness in her plotting. 'Cause the word of God is quick and powerful. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. It is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. It comes through relationship with God. That when you have a relationship with God, that's why you don't have to worry about folk who plotting and planning. Because when you have a relationship with God, God gives you a spirit of discernment. And so Joseph could see through the evilness of what she was doing. That was the character of evil, but then that was the discernment of the craftiness of evil. He hearkened not unto her to lie by her or to be with her. Potiphar's wife tried some crafty compromises in her effort to seduce Joseph, but he was wise and saw through the crafty compromises. Some people cannot recognize sin unless it is full grown. Again, that's why Paul says, stand free in the liberty whereby you have been set free. We're no longer bondage, bound by sin, because Christ has set us free from the bondage of sin. Before Christ came and died for us, we was bound by sin. We had no other choice but to sin. David says, we were born and shaped in iniquity, and in sin did our mothers conceive us. It's our nature to sin. It's a part of who we are. But because Christ has died for us, we're no longer bound by sin. And so Paul says, stand in the liberty whereby you have been set free. Sin no longer have you bound. And so as James says, that when you fall into sin, you're only doing what's in your heart. Yeah. Because sin no longer have you bound. And as I said before, temptation is not sin. Yielding to temptation is sin. And when you yield to the sin, the temptation, then the sin that comes forth is what's in your heart. I told you, you can't be talking about the devil made me do it. No. No. He would love to take credit for it, but he can't. And so Joseph, he recognized the character of the evil. He recognized the craftiness of the evil. You need to recognize sin in the seed and in its many disguises, or you will fall to temptation every time. You got to understand the many disguises that temptation dresses itself up in. I'm sure a whole lot of us have come to realize now that Satan doesn't look like the little devil, the little picture that they had painted for us a long time ago. Satan can come in many different disguises, and he can look really, really pleasant to the eye. And so you got to understand the many disguises, the many hats that temptation wears. And the only way you can understand that, you have to have a discerning spirit, that you may be able to see the craftiness in the many ways that temptation will present itself. The discerning in the service, but then there's the devoutness of the service. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? Joseph was concerned about sinning against God. He was very devoted to God and insisted on God being honored in all that he did. All sin is primarily against God. If we would honor God, we will have to live holy lives. Note that Joseph did not decline on the basis of her becoming pregnant or on the basis of this getting back to your husband. Because to do so would be to compromise. Y'all missed it. Y'all missed it. To do so would be to compromise. If Joseph would have said, no, you might get pregnant or this might get back to your husband, that's compromise, because now you just entertain what she wanted you to do. But Joseph said, no, how could I displease God by sinning against God? This thing ain't about you getting pregnant. This ain't about your husband finding out. This is about my relationship to God. This is about me dishonoring God. I just told you, you got to be careful of the many ways that temptation disguises itself. The minute we start, well, no, I can't do it because of this here. No, I can't do it because of that. Now you're compromising. You got to stand firmly, not wavering. There ain't no compromising. When we're pleasing God, either we're going to please God or we're not. Joseph said, how can I sin against God? Now, some folk would probably say, well, this ain't about God. Everything we do is about God. There is nothing we do that does not concern God. Everything we do is about God. And so Joseph says, how could I do this here against God? If that is what keeps you from immorality, then you have very little character. Real character keeps itself from sin because sin dishonors God. Joseph was concerned with honoring God. He wanted to please God. There is the war against temptation. He did not waver in his stand. He did not waver in his service. And then third, he didn't waver from separating. Sometimes, I know we say sanctified and filled with the Holy Ghost. Sometimes you just have to get out of the appearance of temptation. He didn't waver from separating. In other words, Joseph said, ain't too safe to run. Whatever it takes to please God, if I gotta run, I gotta run. But he didn't waver in separating. First, there is the determination and the separation. He refused. He hearkened not unto her. He left his garment in her hand and he fled. Joseph's response to temptation was no every time. He didn't entertain it. He didn't flirt with it. He didn't compromise with it. Temptation is persistent and determined. And therefore, we must be just as persistent and just as determined, or our refusal of temptation, if we're going to overcome it, will be of no avail. Temptation plays by a totally different set of rules than those who will choose to live righteous. Anytime you make a conscious decision to live your life for God, you had better know that the enemy is coming at you. Let me just get rid of the notion that once you're saved, You're all right. Once you have come into relationship with the Lord, you're free from all of that stuff. Well, let me just put this out there. Because once you give your life to Christ, once you make a conscious decision to live your life for God, it's going to be as if all hell breaks loose on you. Every time you turn around, there's going to be something coming your way. Every time you make the decision to do what's right, there's going to always be evil present. Every time you even think about doing something that's worthwhile for the Lord, the enemy is going to provoke you to do wrong. You got to understand something, that just because you decided to live your life for the Lord, that Satan is going to leave you alone. He's going to come even more forcefully, and he's going to come more fervently. And you need to understand that if you're going to live your life for the Lord, you're going to have to stand firmly on what you have professed in God. He was determined to please God. And so there is a determining in the separation. Joseph fled from out of her presence. Because remember on last week when I told you that sometimes the appearance of temptation can be very aggressive. Some folk are going to make you do what they're requesting. And so Joseph's determination was to separate. And then there is the departing in the separation. He hearkened not unto her. To be with her, Joseph simply fled her presence. He got out from among her. Joseph separated from evil. He was not just going to keep company with evil, nor be in a place where evil was being pursued. Somewhere or another, Joseph must have heard that birds of a feather, they flock together. If you're not doing the same thing evil is doing, then you shouldn't be in the presence of it. Because it's just a matter of time before some folk come and see you flocking. And I ain't got time to be trying to defend what I'm not doing. And so Joseph said, instead of me trying to defend not doing anything wrong, I'm just getting out of the presence of it. Joseph said, I'm just fleeing from it. And so if you are not part of it, then you shouldn't be associated with it. You shouldn't attach yourself to it. And if it's an evil thing, you ought to get out of the presence of it. Separate yourself from it. Separation is a good habit to learn in any age, and is most effective when trying to defeat temptation. There are some places. And there are some philosophies that we need to separate ourselves from. If we are going to maintain virtue in our lives, the Bible says to come out from among them and be ye separate. David says, but know that the Lord has set apart for himself those who will live godly lives. You can't live your life for the Lord and still be associated and attached to people who are living contrary to what the Word of God says. If you're going to live a consecrated life unto the Lord, you must live a separated life. a life that's free from those who continue to live as evil, those who continue to live a life that is contrary to what the Word of God is teaching us about how we are to live our lives. Joseph separated himself not only from Potiphar's wife, but he separated himself from evil, period. And I got news for you today. If you think you can flock with those who continue to live contrary to the Word of God, then you're putting yourself in a position to be compromised. You're putting yourself in a position for folk to wonder whether or not you're saved. And they're putting yourself in a position where folk are now going to question everything they saw you doing when you came to church service. You're putting yourself in a position now you're under scrutiny. Everything you did that concerns God, everybody is looking at to see whether or not it's been real. You have to separate yourself. Come out from among. There are some folk. I'm just saying, man, I ain't talking about nobody, but there are some folk that we should have separated from long time ago. There are some places we should have stopped going a long time ago. Because if you think you can dibble and dabble and play with temptation, then you're flirting with disaster. We know in our personal lives that there are some people, there are some places, some things that we should have separated a long time ago from. And we continue to try to hold on to them. And God keep moving them. He keep taking us away. And we go and we bring them right back into our lives. And then we wonder why we keep going through what we're going through. If God has separated you from them, leave them where they are. Joseph wasn't that saved that he couldn't flee from the presence of the temptation. We are not that saved. Don't fool yourself. The minute you think that you can hang around people that promote evil, the minute you think you can go to places that promote evil doing, then you're only fooling yourself. We're putting ourselves in a position to compromise our faith. And sometimes I say, because of what we're professing and because of what we're doing has confused a lot of people. Because people look for consistency in what we're saying and what we're doing. And when you profess one thing and you do something different, it confuses people. It leaves them, well, I thought they were saved. We have to stand fast and what we have professed. And we have to stand faithfully in what we believe and in what we're doing. Joseph overcame the war against temptation because of his stand, because of his service, and because he knew to separate. And so if we're going to fight the war of temptation, then you're going to have to stand, you're going to have to continue to serve. And there are times when you're simply going to have to separate, get out the presence. But know that when you decide to live your life for the Lord, the enemy is going to come by any means necessary. If it's through your family, if it's through your friends, if it's through your church family, your co-workers, he comes by any means necessary. And you have to know the many disguises in which temptation presents itself if you're going to be able to fight against it. God bless you. God keep you. It's our prayer.
Won't you help me thank God for Pastor's teaching on how to war against temptation and how to win the war against temptation. The Bible, Pastor Ivy, won't you come? The Bible teaches us to choose ye this day. Choose ye this day whom you will serve. If it be Baal, then serve Baal. If it be God, then serve God. But choose ye this day.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Beautiful, beautiful message.
Yes, it was.
I will ask you to just take some time out to read Genesis 39 again. Amen. Amen. Joseph. Wow. The Bible says Joseph ran. Amen. And my thing was, how could he do that? And the Lord opened my eyes and led me right to Romans 8. And I just want to share this with you because I think today will be a great day to give your life to Christ. Romans 8 and 9 said this: you are not controlled by your evil nature, which is sin. You are controlled by the Spirit. Joseph was controlled by the Spirit. When the Spirit said, run, he ran. Today, maybe you've been trying to stop doing this and trying to stop doing that, but for some reason, you couldn't. I can tell you why. Because you don't have the Holy Spirit with you to guide you. The only way you can have the Holy Spirit, you're going to have to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Today is a good day. Tomorrow is not promised to anyone. Yesterday is long forgotten. Jesus said, I'll forgive you for your sins. All you have to do is ask him. So I'm asking you now, if you have sin in you, ask the Lord to forgive you. And he will forgive you. It's just that easy. And when you do that, you'll have the Holy Spirit with you to guide you and to talk with you and tell you, run! Just like he told Joseph. And Joseph was obedient and ran. It's just that easy. Just ask the Lord to forgive you of your sins. And he will forgive you. And once you have done that, my advice to you will be to find you a Bible-based church. I can vouch for this church right here. This man of God is truly a man of God that's standing on the word. Come to the Lord. Come to the Lord. To God be the glory. Amen.
Come on, just say reach as
reach as to me.
Come on, can we all just open our mouth and say, you are my strength.
You are my strength.
We are strength.
Oh!
say in the fullness of.
In the fullness of your grace.
In the
God be the glory for the wonderful things he has done. We thank God again for this time and for this opportunity. Thank God once again for those of you who are here to make this service possible. Thank God for those of you who have tuned in. Pray that something was said or done that has inspired and encouraged you. Also want to ask that we continue to pray for the Reed family and the passing of Deacon Reed. I think the funeral services is Thursday at Cathedral of Faith at 12 o'clock. Also in the passing of Pastor Robert Ingram. Let us continue to pray for those families and also those families that have lost loved ones previously to their passing. I want to pray that God will continue to strengthen and comfort the families. Again, also for the many families that have lost loved ones due to the COVID-19 virus, the many that have been infected by the COVID-19 virus, want to pray that God will continue to strengthen and comfort. Also want to continue to lift up our sick and shut-in, that God will continue to look down upon them. There's a number of sick and shut-in members that we also have that we want to continue to pray and lift up. And also, if there's any that's here, I want to pray that God will continue to bless and strengthen you and your families as well. Again, we thank God for providing us with this opportunity. We thank God for all that he's done for us, that all that he's doing. We continue to praise and bless God. And as we prepare to depart from this place, but never his presence, we want to ask that we just continue to pray for one another, that we continue to lift up one another, that we be our brothers and sisters keepers, and that we would do as the Bible encouraged us to do, to pray for one another. Amen.
Amen.
Let us receive our benediction. Father God, we thank you once again for this time and opportunity. Thank you for allowing us this privilege to declare your gospel, Heavenly Father. We pray that someone was blessed, that something has been received upon hearing this gospel, that someone's life may be changed, that someone may be saved, Heavenly Father. We thank you for this opportunity, and we're just praying, Heavenly Father, that you will continue to bless us with all that we stand in need of, that you will continue to bless families all across this land, Heavenly Father, that you will continue to bring about healing upon this land. God, we're just praying that your will be done in all things. We're praying for the many families, God, that have lost loved ones due to the COVID-19. We're praying for the many that have been infected, Heavenly Father, that you will continue to watch over, protect, God. I pray your will be done. I pray, Heavenly Father, for all of our sick and shed in, Heavenly Father, that you will continue to strengthen, that you will continue to bear them up, Heavenly Father. God, for you are the great physician, you are the great healer, for you are the giver and taker of life, and Heavenly Father, so we put all of the sickness, all of the healing, all of those who lives are on the line. We put it all in your hands, God, for you are more than able to do exceeding and abundantly above all that we ask or think. And we're asking for traveling mercy. We ask we prepare to depart from this place. Keep your hedge of protection around us. Keep us from hurt, harm, and danger. Keep us from endangering others. Bless every home that's represented, at every household, every family here and that have tuned in, Heavenly Father. Pray that you would meet us all at the point of our knees. God, we thank you. We give you glory. We give you honor. And now may the grace of our Lord and Savior, the communion of his Holy Spirit, rest, rule, and abide with us all now and forevermore. Those who love the Lord say amen.
Amen. Amen.
Let's close out with this. Hey, see, you are my strength.
You are my strength.
Strength like no other.
Strength like no other.
Strength like no other.
Strength like no other.
Reach
as to me.
Come on, say, in the fullness.
In the fullness. Your grace.
Another Sunday in the shallows, just remembering that God loves me.
What's up?
What's up, and happy Sunday to you.
Happy Sunday to you as well.
Where's your floaty?
I didn't bring one.
Why not?
It's Sunday morning. It's time to bask in the word of the Lord.
You're not going to stay here with me in the shallows and just relax?
I've been in the shallows long enough. I have questions.
Like what type of questions?
Like who I am, who God is, what am I supposed to be doing?
I know all of that.
Really? Then how do I fight without doing wrong? What gifts do I have? How do I use those gifts? What am I supposed to be doing now? How am I supposed to deal with what's going on?
That's all in the Bible?
It's all in there, beneath the surface.
Well, I've been in the shallows long enough, and I want to see what's beneath the surface too.
Come on, let's go get you some scuba gear.
Okay.
But drop the floaty. You won't be needing it.
Welcome, family and friends. Reverend Jamel Ross here. And we're here to start the first part of our series, Dive In. How many of you have gone to the beach to see the ocean, whether alone or with friends and family? While you're there, you'll see two types of people there. The first will be those that you find lounging in their chairs, or perhaps walking along the seashore collecting shells, or just waiting just enough along the edge of the ocean to allow the waves to wet their feet. They are happy and content with just waiting gently at the ocean. But then again, you have the second type of people that you see there. They are the ones that are ready to just jump into the water. They dive headfirst into the waves. They're not content with seeing the remnants of what exists in the ocean. No, they're diving in to see it in its actual habitat. That's the way it is with the Word of God. There are many Christians who treat their faith just as those who walk gently along the shore, satisfied with what the waves bring in, satisfied with the remnants of what they've heard exists out there. But the Word of God is encouraging us to dive in, to go deep, to see all that it has for us. And it's full of some good stuff. Don't just stick your toe in the water. Dive in and begin to smell like the seawater. Get to see everything in its natural habitat. How can you experience all that God has for you if you just wait for it to come to you? You see, those that go out are like scuba divers, and they really are committed. They are committed to discover what's down in the water, what's beneath the waves. They're willing to go that extra mile to explore the coral reefs, to see the sea life that is there, to actually see where those seashells come from. Today, we're going to start this series where we'll encourage you to go deeper in the Bible. We'll show you how to do it and the wonderful treasures you'll find as you go deeper. You see, the Bible's a book that is full of stuff. It's full of knowledge. It's full of interesting facts and wisdom. And it holds answers to all, not some, but all of life's questions that you might have. It is the living Word of God. Just as the ocean, it is full of living creatures. And we'll find in today's scriptural passage how it is going to teach us how to live.
But don't let it faze you. Stick with what you learned and believed, sure of the integrity of your teachers. Why? You took in the sacred scriptures with your mother's milk. There's nothing like the written word of God for showing you the way to salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. Every part of scripture is God breathed and useful one way or another, showing us truth, exposing our rebellion, correcting our mistakes, training us to live God's way. Through the word, we are put together and shaped up for the task God has for us.
So, in our scripture, 2 Timothy, we find two gentlemen here. So we have Timothy and we have Paul. Paul and Timothy were boys. They worked together and they were with each other for a period of time. To be exact, Tim hung out with Paul and learned a lot of things from him as to how he was to live his life, how he was to go about doing his business, and his business was to share the word of God. But the two of them were friends and they worked together, and together they brought a lot of people to Christ. But then one day, it was time for Timothy to go off on his own.
now. We find here where Paul is trying to encourage Timothy and say, don't be afraid. You've got what it takes. But he's instructing him on what he needs to remember to do. That's what the Bible does for us. And this scripture tells us you don't have to freak out. If you have to start out in a new class, new job, new relationships, whatever, believe it or not, your answer is in the Word of God. So Paul begins to speak to Timothy and encourage him, said, don't trip. You already know. Remember when you were young, his mom and his grandmother, they always brought him up to know what to do and instructed him exactly what to do. He says, continue to do that. But not only that, make sure you follow the scriptures. Follow the instructions of what you are to do. If you're going to bake a cake, you need to follow those instructions or you'll have a glob of a wet mess. Or if you wanted to get to the next level in a video game, you have to be mindful of what you need to do or you'll have to start all over. So Paul was encouraging Timothy to follow what he had already learned, what he had heard, and guess what? What he had seen he himself and Paul do together with great success. Follow the instructions. Do what you have learned because you can be well equipped to do what God has called you to do. You can be successful by following God's instructions. What was really key was he says, follow God's instructions. And we hear that as we grow up. But what are God's instructions? Where can I find God's instructions? You're always talking about follow the instructions, follow his rules. Where are they? Well, I'm here to tell you right now, his instructions are the Word of God. This Bible, it is full of his instructions. It tells us how to live a successful life. And there's nothing, I mean nothing, that you can run across that the Bible does not address. To be exact, the Bible is many things. It contains history. Yes, it does. Like it tells us about the story of the children of Israel, which is very true today. It's even a love story because it talks of how God so loved us, what he did, that he paid a price to save us. It's full of wisdom. As a matter of fact, it'll tell you how to not only save money, but how to live a successful life. It even is the first 23andMe, the first finding your roots. It gives genealogical information. It'll tell you whose mother, grandmother, great-grandmother, it goes back 10 and 20 generations. It gives genealogical reference of who's related to who's related to who, all the way down through Jesus and how we're even connected. 23andMe. It has songs, it has poems, it has parables, prophecies, and firsthand accounts of who Jesus is. It's got a lot going on in this book. But we don't know about it until we dive in to discover. You'll find who you are in the Bible. You'll find what you were created to do in this book. You will find how to do what you were created to do in this book. Every part of this Bible teaches us something. It teaches us something about ourselves. It teaches us something about others. And it teaches us about God. There are books in the Bible such as Psalms,
They teach us how to dance and to sing songs. Proverbs, it teaches us rules and how we can avoid sin. And then, like in our scripture today with 2 Timothy, it teaches us how to study, how to follow instructions, to listen to what it is we need to do to accomplish the task we've been asked to accomplish. And there's a beautiful book called Revelation. It's the last book of the Bible. And it tells us of our beautiful forever home in heaven. It tells you how it's furnished. It tells you that you have your own. All of this in this one book. It also reminds us that it is God-breathed. As long as this Bible has been around, it has encouraged, it has saved, and it has instructed millions of people, and it has never changed. There is something to be said about the Bible. During these next couple of weeks, we will be going through how you read the Bible, how you study it, the benefits of memorizing verses, because it'll come back to help you when it's time for you to. It'll remind us of beautiful stories in the Bible and how they apply to our lives. You see, God wants us to be bold believers, and we can't be satisfied with where we are. There's so much more to our lives. There's so much more to life. And He didn't create us just to sit on the shore and watch the waves go back and forth. He didn't create us to wait to get the remnants of what's been washed up. He created us to be bold, to dive in, to see all that He has for us, and then to be instructed on how to obtain what we want and what we need. The Bible is like an ocean. It is filled with wisdom and knowledge, and it can completely transform your life. What you think you know, you read it again and you get more information, and it tells you you are more than that. But if all we do is stay in the shallows, we'll never really know God's full plan for our lives. We'll know that God loves us, yes. But we need to understand how He loves us, how we can know that He loves us. We can know that there are troubles and trials that are come our way. We'll know that we're going to have some hard times. But if we study the Bible, He'll even tell us what they are, and He'll tell us how to get through it or get around it. It's all in the Bible. He gives us encouragement through what others have gone through so that when we face it, we know what the key is to success. God wants us to dive deep. And the Bible, it has all of the answers that we need. God is just strictly waiting for us to dive in and discover it. So why would anyone want to snorkel or scuba dive? It's easy just to wade on the shore or in the shallow ends of the pool or even of the ocean. But when you choose to dive deep and put forth an effort, you will begin to see all the beautiful sights that there are, all of the beautiful things that are there waiting for you if you just dare dive in. As Paul says in this letter to Timothy, it's valuable. This letter has many uses, but the really reason we want to study God's word, we want to know God better. We want to know Jesus better, absolutely. And if we know who He is, then we know who we are, because we are who we are because of everything He has done for us. And He lays it out. He tells us that He loves us. He tells us how much. He tells us what He did for us. But then He says, I have something for you. I have something great waiting for you.
But in order for you to get it, you gotta come into the deep. Come on into the deep. Come on. You won't be alone. You have instructions. Just as you were learning to swim, they taught you what you needed to do, how to hold your breath, how to kick your feet, how to use your arms, how to breathe. The Bible is your swimming instructor. And once you get through the first pages and you know that you can swim safely, then you should have no problem going out into the deep. Hey, come join me. Let's put our snorkel mask on and even in our fins, and let's dig deep and see all that God has for us, because it's beautiful. It is fantastic. And you'll see things you have never, ever imagined for your life by going deeper. So we invite you to come on and dive in to the Word of God. So let us pray. Oh God, our Father, we thank you for the gift of life, and we thank you for inviting us to dive in. We thank you for your Word, which will instruct us, it will encourage us, it will guide us, it will heal us. God, we thank you for your Word, that you did not leave us to our own selves. Thank you for your Scriptures, which are God-breathed, which we know you sent to us. And we know if we want the things of you, the things of God, that if we follow your instructions, you have assured us, oh God, by following these instructions, we shall take hold. We shall have what you promised us. So we thank you for showing us your promises, being faithful to put it in writing so we can hold you to it. Thank you. We thank you for giving us examples of how wonderful your Word is through nature, such as the ocean. And we ask, oh God, that if anyone calls out upon your name, as your Word says, that you will invite them in into the deep, and they can be assured that they will be helped. Help us to help those that are venturing out. Help us to lead others to you. And we thank you for the beauty in your Word. We thank you for all things wonderful. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen.